Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So these lectures are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. Right, in those examinations you require to answer the few questions related to the day-to-day current affairs. Right, so we are basically the future IAS who are conducting these sessions. On the day-to-day basis, you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube to get the daily current affairs, right, on the day-to-day basis. And you must also read the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers for your, you know, better understanding. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is basically the project or the movement called Pagri Samhal movement. Pagri means turban, okay, in English. Samhal means to take care of your turban movement, okay. So this movement was started by, you know, Ajit Singh. Ajit Singh was basically the uncle of, you know, basically your freedom fighter Bhagat Singh, okay. In 1907, when the British government passed a three controversial laws related to the agriculture, Ajit Singh, who was basically the uncle of the freedom fighter Bhagat Singh, has started this Pagri Samhal movement on that point of the time to protest against such unjust three farm laws which were brought by the British government in 1907. All right. So here, this time also, now you know that ongoing protest is going on at Delhi border. Specifically, the farmers belongs to the Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan basically are protesting at the borders of Delhi, okay, to roll back, right, the three controversial farm laws which were passed by the Narendra Modi led NDA government. All right, so they were demanding to repeal those farm laws. Okay, so a morcha called Samyukta Kisan Morcha, right, which is basically consisting of the organizations of, you know, the farmers, right, the Samyukta Kisan Morcha basically said that February 23rd would be celebrated as a Pagri Samhal Divas. Okay, why this Pagri Samhal Divas? Because it will be, you know, across, it will be a movement, right, or it will be a day that will be celebrated across the globe, right? And the Samyukta Samaj Kisan Morcha has asked all the supporters who support this movement or who support this protest, right, specifically from the farmers' side against these three unjust laws, to support this ongoing protest across the globe by bearing a red pagri, by bearing a green pagri or green turban, or for the females you can use also the dupatta. Okay, so if you are supporting of these, you know, the controversial, if you are supporting the protest which is related to or which is against the three farm controversial laws, right, you should bear a green turban or green dupatta to mark your solidarity or your support towards that movement. Okay, and also the Samyukta Kisan Morcha also asked the people who support this movement to put their pictures on the social media also, right, along with the hashtag Go Green for the farmers, because here the farmers are protesting, right, against these three unjust laws according to the Samyukta Kisan Morcha. And the people who support this movement basically asked to wear the green turban or green dupatta, right, as a solidarity in support of that movement. Okay, if you go back in 1907, okay, the farmers also protested at that point of the time, but that point of the time the protest was led by the Ajit Singh, who was the uncle of freedom fighter Bhagat Singh, right, and who was also the founder of the Pagri Samhal movement, which was started in 1907. Okay, now at that point of the time in 1907, the Pagri Samhal movement or Pagri Samhal Jatta was basically a successful farm agitation. Okay, it was a successful because it has forced the British government to take away or to repeal those controversial three farm laws which were related to the agriculture at that point of the time. Okay, and basically the Ajit Singh, who was the uncle of Bhagat Singh, was basically a main person who were behind those agitations, right? And according to, you know, the Ajit Singh, right, this agitation was basically a channel through which, you know, the people's anger can also be channelized, okay, over those farms laws, over those unjust and controversial farm laws, right? And that were used basically to topple, or that can be used to topple the colonial government at that point of the time, okay? So the three farm laws which were there at, you know, which were there during 1907, right, has brought the storm in 1907, right, which were related to the Punjab Land Alienation Act 1900 and the Punjab Land Colonization Act 1906 and the Dowari Act 1907. All right. So here, you know, what were these laws were related, right? The British government has brought these laws intentionally, right, for the various purpose. Obviously, the Land Alienation Act was basically brought to alienate the real owners from their own farms, okay, or their from their own lands. So here, the farmers would be reduced from the owners to contractors, right? So they will be reduced from owner to the contractors, and that will give the British government a sweeping power, right? Very large power to take back the allotted land of those particular, you know, a particular, you know, contractor, if the farmer even touched or even cut any tree in his field without the permission from the British, right? So some very controversial provisions were there at that point of the time. The main motto of the British government was to alienate the people from their land, okay, and to take over the land from the farmers for basically various purposes. All right. So you can see he was the Ajit Singh who were behind, the Pagri Sabhal movement that was started in 1907. All right. Then the smart code platform. What is the smart code platform? It is basically, you know, it is a platform where you will have the open source code, or you will have the repository of open source code, right? Which is related to the housing and urban development. So here, the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs ministers, Hardeep Singh Puri, launched a smart code platform. Okay, this platform is basically, you know, an enabling feature where all stakeholders related to the urban and housing, right, these all stakeholders would contribute to the repository of this open source code. This open source code would provide various solutions, right, to the urban governance, to the problems related to the urban governance, as well as it will have the huge applications and implications to the urban governance also. Okay, this open source code would provide, right, or would address different challenges which were related to the urban governance, or the related to the urban local bodies which were entrusted to have, or which were entrusted to basically, you know, execute the urban governance in the urban areas, because you have a lot of difficulties in delivering those services, right, related to the development. For example, the deployment of digital applications to address various challenges specifically in the urban areas. Okay, so the urban areas would basically, you know, try to find out very difficult to cope such challenges, so that to enable those cities to take advantage of the existing codes rather than, you know, developing the new solutions, right, from the scratch, right? So, and simultaneously customizing those existing codes, right, as, you know, as to suit the local need in the urban local self-governance level. Okay, so it will be a repository of the open source software. Okay, so there the source code will be available on the platform free of cost. There will not be any charge, okay, for the use, and that will be without any licensing or the subscription fees. Okay, that will be, you know, providing lot of applications related to the urban governance, and that will basically limit the cost to those involved while customizing the code as well as developing the locally relevant solution to the urban local self-governing structure. All right. So he is basically, right. Next, the cadmium doped silver antimony telluride, that is the chemical formula is AgSbTe2. So what is silver, the chemical, right? The formula is Ag, right? The antimony is Sb, and telluride is Te. Okay, so it is the chemical formula for this. Now you must understand that due to lot of problems in the urban areas, right, Now, the government is all over the world. The governments are trying to convert the waste into some sort of a energy recovery. Okay. So here, a lot of applications are there, right, which convert the waste into energy. And that energy will be used for the recovery as well as for other domestic applications purpose, right? Now, this conversion of this waste heat, right? For example, in the urban areas, a lot of waste is generated. If you use that waste to generate the heat, and ultimately that heat will be used for generation of the power, okay? For, say, for the equipments or for automobiles, right? The scientists have found, right? Or scientists had already developed the lead, right? As a source that can basically, you know, or lead as a basically the important application which can convert the heat or waste heat into the power. Okay. Now, different thermoelectric materials have been developed, right, in the world, which can convert this waste heat to the power. But it consisting of the lead. The lead is heavy material or heavy metal, which is basically, you know, the carcinogenic also, and which is also polluting in the nature. This heavy metal can cause the cancer and other life-threatening diseases. Okay. Now, the scientist has developed the new lead-free material, right? Right. This lead-free materials would have the ability to convert the waste heat into the power. Okay. So, it will be the most efficient thermoelectric material, which was developed by the scientist, right? Which were previously related to the lead, but now it has been replaced by the lead-free material, right? And that will have the market applications also. So this has developed by the scientists from the Jawaharlal Nehru Center for the Advanced Science and Research, which is located at Bengaluru, which is nothing but an autonomous institution of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Okay, now have identified this lead-free material, which is the cadmium-doped, the silver antimony telluride, AgSbTe2, all right? And this material, which is basically, you know, lead-free, can efficiently allow the recovery of the electricity from the waste heat, okay? And that will have the paradigm shift in terms of your heat recovery or in terms of your, you know, the energy recovery, all right? And this work or this project is basically supported by the Swarn Jayanti Fellowship and project fund from the Science and Engineering Research Board, okay? And the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Okay. Next, the National Awards for Technology Innovation in the Petrochemicals Downstream Plastics Processing Industries. Okay. So obviously, by the name, you can see that they are the national awards. They were national awards which were instituted by the Government of India. Specifically, you say the Ministry of Chemicals and the Fertilizers, right? Every year, right, provides those national awards for those technology innovations which provide, right, some sort of a, you know, the petrochemical and downstream plastics processing, right, type of applications, specifically at the industrial level. So, right, for those innovations, the national awards have been given. Okay, so this year, the Union Minister of Chemicals and the Fertilizers presented the 10th National Award for the Technology Innovations. Okay, specifically in the petrochemical and downstream plastics processing industries to the awardees. Okay, so this is the 10th such award. That means these awards were basically instituted or announced, right? So these were basically in the lines of the national policy on the petrochemicals, which were basically announced in the April 2007 by the Department of Chemical and the Petrochemicals, Government of India, okay, which has ultimately set up this award scheme, okay? This award would definitely incentivize, right, those industries, right, which can have certain set of technological innovation in the petrochemical field, right, in terms of the processing, right, of those, you know, the petrochemicals in the field of the polymeric materials, in the field of, right, the products, in the field of energy recovery, in the fields of the national and social importance. So these awards will be given to those innovations, okay? The ultimate aim of instituting this award is to develop and maintain the petrochemical industries as vibrant as the global competitive industry, because now there is a stiff competition globally regarding this petrochemical and the processing industries. So if you provide certain incentives to the industry, obviously that will have the cutting edge you know, the innovation, and that will be beneficial for development of Indian petrochemical industry that can compete globally also in that industry. And simultaneously, it can also have the ability to generate the eco-friendly process and the technologies, which will be ultimately cutting down the greenhouse gas emissions and other, you know, other negative implications on the environment. So here, the Central Institute of Petroleum Engineering, Petrochemicals Engineering and the Technology, which is an autonomous institution under the Department of Chemicals and the Petrochemicals, right? So this has an autonomous institution have been entrusted the responsibility of implementing this scheme of the National Awards for Technology Innovation, specifically in the petrochemicals, right? And, you know, in the processing industries. Okay. Then the Khela Hove. What is that Khela Hove? First of all, you must understand now in the West Bengal, right? The state assembly elections are due. Okay. Now, almost all parties are competing, right, specifically on the soils of the West Bengal. Both BJP and the ruling Trinamool Congress, both are basically, you know, both are basically competing to get the maximum number of seats from the West Bengal, specifically in the legislative assembly elections. Okay, now, slogan have been coming out from almost all quarters of political party, including the BJP also using this slogan, that is Khela Hove slogan, okay? So what is that Khela Hove? First of all, let me explain what is Khela Hove. So Khela Hove is a slogan, okay? That means, Khela Hove means the game is on. The game is on, right? There is, you know, the game still is on, okay? That is basically to ask the opponents, specifically the opposition political parties, to wait till the game is got over. And it will be decided on that time that who will have the last laugh. Who will have the last laugh means it will be decided at the later point of the time who will win the crucial segment, crucial legislative assembly elections. Okay. So that means in the Khela Hove, the slogan, the political parties are asking or challenging their opponents to wait and watch. Right? Right? Just like a battlefield, the game is on. Okay. And the game is not yet decided yet, okay, or the battle is not yet decided yet. You have to wait and see who will be having the last laugh. So that means it is just, and you know, basically challenging their opponent parties. So here the slogan was first used by Bangladesh Awami League, right, MP Shamim Osman, 4 years ago. Okay, now it is popularized in the West Bengal by Trinamool Congress president of the Birbhum district in the West Bengal region. That was the Anubrata Mondal, who was basically the Trinamool Congress president of the Birbhum district, who popularized this slogan called Khela Hove, okay, at the local political event. Right? Here, you know, the Anubrata Mondal basically says that Boyankar Khela Hove, Boyankar, that means it will be, you know, the game is on, it will be a dangerous game. Boyankar means a dangerous, right? In the Bengali, they call basically, we say Bhayankar, right? That is a dangerous, right? Bhayankar is the Hindi word for the dangerous, but they say Boyankar, right? So it is the Boyankar Khela Hove means the game is dangerous, game is on. You have to wait and watch who will ultimately win that, you know, basically your elections. So this slogan that the political parties are challenging their opponents to wait and watch, right? It is just like a political battleground, right? And it has not yet decided yet. So, right, the time will tell you that who will have the last laugh on the soils of West Bengal. Okay, so both of the BJP and the Trinamool Congress are, you know, loggerheads on the West Bengal soil. Okay, next, the Leh as an exam center for the civil services examination. So this is a very good news for the new union territory, that is Ladakh, which was originated after the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act 2019. The Ladakh has become a union territory, apart from the Jammu and Kashmir also become a union territory. Okay, now this time, first time, right, the Leh, which are the part of the union territory of Ladakh, will have the examination center for the preliminary examination, okay? Or the civil services preliminary examination center, the Leh will be, 73rd of such center. It is the first of kind decided by the Union Public Service Commission, which has opened a new center in the Leh. Okay, so that will be good news for those students who are writing this examination of the civil services examination from the Leh region. Okay, so the sanctioning of this new center, right, for the civil services examination in the Leh is of great relief, right, for, you know, for basically for those students which are aspiring to become a civil servants, right. Now the Leh will be 73rd such center in our country to hold this preliminary examination, which will be held on 27th of June this year. All right. Now the Leh deputy commissioner, right, will be coordinating supervisor for this examination center at the Leh, right? And estimated at one estimate around 800 candidates are expected to appear the civil services preliminary examination this year, and those candidates will get benefited out of this new center. All right. Then the Central Employment Guarantee Council. What is that? First of all, the Central Employment Guarantee Council was basically constituted under the MG Narega Act 2005. Okay. Now the 22nd meeting of the Central Employment Guarantee Council was basically held on 23rd of February 2021, right, which were basically chaired by the Union Minister of Rural Development. Okay. Now, as I said, that the Central Employment Guarantee Council is set up under the Section 10 of the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, that is popularly known as MG Narega Act 2005. Okay. Now, since this year is basically all gone because of the pandemic, Corona pandemic. Okay. Now, but the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act provides, right, and played a very active role, right, in providing the wage employment to, you know, to the workers, specifically in the rural areas. Okay. So here at one, you know, the estimate 344 crore person days employment have been generated so far, right? And which is the highest ever person day generated so far in any year. Okay. Which is around 44% higher than the last year during the same period. So despite of the Corona, the Ministry of Rural Development has credited with, you know, creation of 344 crore person days employment avenues, specifically in the rural areas. And this year, 69 crore new job cards have been issued, right? Which is, right, which is much, much more than the previous year, which also shows that the migrants workers now going back to their villages, right, rather than moving to the, you know, to the urban areas in search of employment. So the main emphasis on the MG Narega is also provide the employment opportunities specifically to those unskilled population who are willing to work, right, in the unskilled work, and simultaneously to stop the migration of the migrants from the rural to the urban areas, and that will have the, you know, the decongestion effect specifically in the urban areas, right? So a lot of other, you know, objectives are also there. Okay. Next, the draft National Migrant Labor Policy. So what is that? So the draft National Migrant Labor Policy was prepared by the Niti Aayog, which is, you know, Government of India's think tank. Okay. Now, the draft National Migrant Labor Policy would definitely have the implications related to the migrant laborers who were facing the different problems like housing shortage, the housing problems, employment related problems, insurance related problems, health related problems. Their children are also suffering from different problems, right? So for them, for their holistic development, a draft National Migrant Labor Policy have been prepared by the Niti Aayog. Okay. So Niti Aayog has prepared this draft, and this draft describes the two approaches to the policy design related to the migrant, you know, the migrant labor. So first is basically the focusing on the cash transfers, special quotas, and the reservations to the migrant population. Okay. So it will have these two approaches, either provide a cash transfer to their directly their accounts, special quotas in certain employment, and reservations specifically in certain, you know, employment, maybe the private also, right? the other, which enhance the agency and the capability of the community. Okay, obviously, right? You know, certain other parameters or certain other, you know, measures will also be taken so that the capability of the community will also increase. Okay, and that will basically remove any hurdles that comes in the way of the individual's ability to thrive. Okay, so remove all, you know, hurdles, remove all barriers, right, so that the migrant worker as an individual can thrive in such environment. Okay, now the policy recognized the right-based approach to the migrants workers. So right-based approach was recognized, and it has rejected the handout approach that were previously implemented. Okay, now the draft which was prepared by the Niti Aayog asked the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, Rural Development and Housing and the Urban Affairs, right, specifically to create the migration resource centers. Okay, these migration resource centers would be a repository for the data. Okay, that data will be taken from the tribal affairs migration data. Okay, that data will ultimately used for creation of the migration resource centers specifically in the high migration zones for the betterment of the conditions of the migrants. Okay, then the draft also asked the Ministry of Skill Development and the Entrepreneurship to focus on the skill building at these centers, specifically the migrant resource centers. So obviously the migrant should be provided, right, enough skill opportunities, the training facilities, vocational training facilities, so that they can thrive by themselves and they can better develop their ability and their skills specifically in, you know, in the industrial level, so that they can get, you know, the gainful employment in India. Okay, next, the draft also asked the Ministry of Education, okay, because you must understand the migrants, right, they are generally illiterate, okay, or they are, you know very low standard of education. Their children are also at the verge of, right, not getting enough educational avenues, right? They are very poor, don't have the space to live and place and all sort of the things, right? Forget about education, they don't have money to pay for the education also, right? So the Ministry of Education should do according to the draft, right? So the Ministry of Education should take all measures under Right to Education Act, which provides the free and compulsory education, right? Which provides the free and compulsory education to the children who are in the age bracket of 6 to 14 years, right? To take all measures under Right to Education to mainstream the migrant children education, which are generally not enrolled in the education, right? To map the migrant children, right? And to provide all avenues for the development, to provide all avenues so that the education is accessible to the children belongs to the migrants, and to provide the local language teachers, because these migrants are basically, you know, they can understand only the language based on their, you know, the linguistic criteria, right? If the teachers are not, you know, the basically, you know, do not speak or, you know, teach the students in the regional language, it will be very difficult, right, for taking the measures related to the children belong to the migrants. So the availability of the local language teachers specifically in the migrant destinations are very, very important, so that we can target the children belonging to the migrant population. Then obviously the migrants generally migrate in the urban areas or from one city to the another city, right? Now what is happening is that there is obviously the housing shortage, right? The migrants are facing very difficulty in terms of, right, addressing those needs related to the shelter. So the draft also asked the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs to take all measures, right, so that it can address the issue related to the night shelters, to provide adequate facilities so that the night shelters are provided for the accommodation of the migrants, right? The short stay homes would be provided to the migrants, right, specifically for those migrants who basically migrate for the short period of the time, right, as well as the seasonal accommodation facilities will also be provided for those migrants who work seasonally, who migrates seasonally, okay? And the draft also asked the National Legal Service Authority, NALSA, and the Ministry of Labor, right, to set up the grievance handling cells and the fast track legal response specifically to the trafficking. Trafficking ka matlab hota hai selling and buying of the person just like a goods and the services. Okay, so here the trafficking is basically, right, something which is to be understood that, right, because the migrants, their children are very poor, they cannot afford, right, all sort of legal services. So the Legal Service Authority Act, which will provide the free legal services to those persons who are basically trapped in the human trafficking, right, and especially the employers who are basically exploiting the situations, right, by not providing the migrants with the minimum wage also. So those employers who violate this minimum wage, right, should be punished, and that should have adequate safeguard for the migrants, right, and to stop the workplace abuses and the accidents related to the migrant workers. All such actions has to be taken as stated by the policy or as stated by the draft, right, National Migrant Policy. Okay, then the National Urban Digital Mission. What is National Urban Digital Mission? Okay, first of all, the National Urban Digital Mission was launched by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs. Okay, the main purpose of National Urban Digital Mission would definitely, first of all, to connect digitally the urban areas. Okay, that means certain, you know, the urban infrastructure should be made digital, right, so that the, you know, the digital accessing, the digital service delivery related to the, you know, the urban services will be delivered to the public with a comparatively shorter period of the time with high efficiency. Okay, so for that purpose, the National Urban Digital Mission was launched by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs, right? It is launched along with the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Okay, now this National Urban Digital Mission will create a shared digital infrastructure, okay, specifically in the urban areas. Okay, here it will work across the three pillars, right, that is people, process, and the platforms, to provide the holistic supports to the cities and the towns, right, in terms of the service delivery. So it is, the main purpose is to institutionalize, right, the city-centric administration, the ecosystem-driven approach, okay, considering the citizen at the nucleus or citizen at the base. So the city-centric administration is very much important, right, to urban governance, right, and that will have the huge impact on the service delivery, right, specifically have the objective of providing all sort of urban service delivery specifically in the cities by 2022, okay, and across all the cities and the towns in India by 2024. It has made this target. Okay, next, the National Urban Digital Mission has articulated a set of governing principles. Okay, this set of governing principles, which will basically having certain technological, you know, integration, technological design principles, which were related to the National Urban Innovation Stack, right. These were strategies and the approach which were previously released by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban, you know, Affairs in the February 2019. So it will have certain principles also. Okay, and the principles give in turn to give rise to the standards, specifications, certifications across the three pillars of people, process, and the platform, so that the holistic development of the urban area will be ultimately taken place. Okay, next is the India Urban Data Exchange. What is India Urban Data Exchange? First of all, you must understand, as the name suggests, Urban Data Exchange. That means it is basically a platform. Okay, so it is basically a platform, or you can say it basically, you know, an interface where the urban data will be exchanged, right, between the different stakeholders or between the different participants. Okay, so here this India's Urban Data Exchange, which was, you know, launched by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs, right, which was specifically launched by the Union Minister of Housing and the Urban Affairs, the Hardeep Singh Puri. Okay, now this has developed, right, in the partnership of the Smart City Mission and the Indian Institute of Science, which is the premier institutions, right, which is located in Bangalore. Okay, the India Urban Data Exchange would serve, right, an interface, right, that will connect or that will basically integrate the data providers, the data users, okay, and as well as all urban bodies, okay, so that these data providers, data users, and urban local bodies, they can share, they can request for any information, and they can access the database related to the cities, the database related to the urban governance, the database related to the urban service delivery, right? If that database, if that sharing, if that, you know, the request and accessing of the database will be available, obviously, that will have the positive implications on the quality of the service specifically in the urban areas, and that will also have the impact on the overall development in the urban areas also. So it is basically an open source software platform, okay, that will facilitate the secure, authenticated, and the managed exchange of the data, right? So that data will be shared, right? Data will be, you know, exchanged, right, on the various platform, various data platform, right? And that will have the third party authenticated and authorized applications also that will be beneficial specifically for the governing or for the governance of the urban areas. All right. So it is India Urban Data Exchange. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next session. Thank you.